Hi, my name is Niyati Shah. I am a sexuality and a parenting coach. I take workshops for parents and children on topics of sex and sex education. So today here I am taking a topic on parenting on sexual education. So we have a lot of topics to nowadays coming under parenting. We want to be the aware parent for our children. We want to make sure we are there for them, giving them the best we can offer in terms of education, in terms of luxuries, in terms of necessities, everything. But this one topic that most of the parents hesitate or feel shy or feel inappropriate to talk about is the sexual education. Now, when I also say that we are talking on sexual education or sex education as we see, this is how basically we mean, you know. So we are saying we are talking about sex education, but when the terms are given out, how is it perceived? It is perceived like this: the sex becomes so big that the education part of it is hardly understood. So this is the first myth usually the parents have, that sex education means you're going to talk about more about sex. So what is the education over there? This is where we want to come in. We want to tell the parents that this is a major part of parenting, or which even the schools don't cover. Parents are not talking to the children, and children have the curiosity to understand about it. They want to know about it. They want to understand what is happening with them. They want to understand why certain things are shown, like in movies, or they see it outside in real life, and there are no answers to them. Lot of parents come to me and say that, Niyati, isn't sex intuitive? We were never told about it. We have two children, we have three children. We were never told about it. So why suddenly this education has come into the picture? So this is the reply I give them. We tell them that don't you teach, like hunger is so intuitive, isn't it? Nobody needs to tell a child that you need to eat, frankly. Like even though as parents we tell them, but they will eat when they are hungry. They will find their food and they will eat it. We never have to tell the child, go to sleep. Whenever they are tired, immediately their eyes will close and they will go to sleep. Yes, sometimes they stretch it. Sometimes they are so playful that they take their time. But at the end, this doesn't have to be taught. We don't even have to teach them that, okay, these are bowel movements and you need to go and, you know, use the washrooms. They immediately know. Yes, as toddlers, they are still understanding, their system is developing, but by the time they are three, they definitely know what is happening to them. So in spite of these things which are so intuitive, which they know they need to do, we will still go about teaching every detail to them. We will tell them what is appropriate, what is inappropriate, what kind of food to eat, how much water to drink, sleep is important, why you need to sleep. We'll spend so much over these things to make it more interesting, to make sure that our children understand why we are teaching them to eat healthy or to sleep appropriately. We make their beds, we buy bed sheets, we have those night lamps. We do so many things for our child. Similarly, sex education is not just about the sexual energy which they are going to feel or the activity which finally they will know, which will come to them intuitively. But there's so much more that they need to understand, which probably we were not told, and we know the consequences. Simple things like you need to hygiene, you need to wash your genitals. That is a part of sex education. You need to probably say, understand what are the changes in your body. So what is happening to you, like the girls getting their periods or the boys having a nightfall. So who is going to explain this to the child? And in today's world, when everything is on their fingertips, the technology is on their fingertips, the mobile phones, the tablets, the computer is at their, they just get it whenever they want it and wherever they want. Even if the parents are strict at home, they're making sure that the child does not see inappropriate stuff. They go to their friend's house. They have Wi-Fi even in cafes. They have Wi-Fi in malls. So they are getting access everywhere. Whenever they have a question, they will get their answers on the fingertips. So now, is it better for a parent to give that information themselves, or should they go Googling about it? So that is what today we want to discuss. It is intuitive, then why we should we train? The first thing I want to talk today is sex education is not just about the sexual activity. It is about understanding the human sexuality. You know, who is a woman, who is a man, what do they feel, what do they understand. We have gays and lesbians as we talk, homosexuality. We have asexuality, like people who don't have the energy at all. So what are these sexualities? What is the person's, like within a woman also, within one woman to another, what I feel and what I like and what I understand is very different from the second. So understanding that every person is different, understanding what the sexual energy is all about, that also comes under sex education. The reproductive anatomy. How many of us do we really know what our reproductive system is all about? So where does the egg come from? How does it settle? What is the procedure in a woman's body or in a man's body? Yes, now we know probably that sperms are produced. But what are the, you know, the few details that we say, how is it produced? Where is it produced? How many are produced? How does it travel? Then is sperm different from semen? So even if I have to ask you today, like even the terms that we use, the parents are not aware. We as individuals are not aware of the genital areas, the names of them, the organ names of the reproductive system. So all this comes under sex education. Emotional relationships, that is also sex education, where we tell them if you are looking in, like the kids have attraction by the teenage, they are feeling attracted to the other gender, they have the romance coming in. So how do you choose your partner? Just because you are full of raging of hormones, will you just go around looking for whoever comes to you or whoever is available? No, because there's so much emotions involved also. So what are these emotional relationships? How do you choose a partner? How are you going to be sure whether this is the partner you want to have your relationships with? Not only in their teens, but even later on. So today you are choosing a partner for marriage. Is money the only thing are you going to look at? Is family the only criteria? Are you going to understand how you gel? So all that comes in under sex education. Of course, the sexual activity. Today, a married couple, suddenly finds out they are not compatible in bed. The woman does not understand. She has just been told whatever your husband does is your duty to offer. Just don't say anything. These are the lessons given to a woman or for the first night and then forward for the married life. So for a woman, sexual activity is all about the man. Yes, for the man, it is a birthright. For me, for a man, he will say, this is what I have to do. So he does not understand that what a woman can want, does want, how to turn on the woman, how to make her feel participative, like how to take her as a participant into the entire activity. So a man also needs to understand that a woman is equal human as a man is. So under sexual activity, it is not just to tell them, okay, this is how it is going to happen and that's the end of it. What is the hygiene behind it? What is your responsibility towards your partner? Whether your partner is comfortable with what you are doing? Whether you want to experiment something new, is your partner okay with it? So this is all explained under the topic of sex education and of course the birth control. Today we have so many queries coming on. We have these new websites coming in where consultants like us give out few hours to chat with people or to answer their queries that come on the website to us. So there are so many queries coming for IPILs now. So many queries. We have at least one query a day minimum. I have taken IPIL just yesterday or day before yesterday. I got a query saying I took an IPIL before the act. Now I have had sex and now should we wonder whether we are going to get pregnant or no? You have to know. Yes. It's after you have the sexual intercourse. Within 72 hours, yes. With the right knowledge. How is it going to affect your health? how is it going to affect her reproductive system, when should you take it, how many times in a month should you take it. Some people think it's a contraceptive pill. Every time they mate, they pop one pill. It's hazardous. You cannot take so many eye pills. Eye pill is an emergency pill. So similarly, birth controls, condoms. Everybody knows about condoms now. Everybody knows. But really, do we know everything about condoms? Exactly. How to wear it, where to keep it, because there are so many condoms that tear. Why are they tearing? Because you've kept it in places which has heat. So what is the material made of? What are the instructions with the condom? We never bother to read or to understand what it is. So birth control is also an important topic which needs to be discussed with kids who now are becoming very sexually active in an early age, and with the adults. In India today, still 50% of marriages and more probably are still arranged marriages. So when two strangers are coming together, if given some understanding beforehand, it could be such a smooth ride, rather than with all the anxiety, with all the pressure, the stress that a bride or the groom, whether I'm performing well or no, whether I've done my job or no, whether I'm man enough or no, if both are taken through the entire procedure with proper understanding, their life would be so much better to start with itself. Even love marriages, this topic is still a pretty much a taboo in our society. So even if it is a love marriage, the girls don't give in very easily into a sexual relationship. But at the same time, the coming generation is very easily manipulated. They explore a lot. So today, the average age of a child or of a person who becomes sexually active is 14 years. So at 14, if we know people are becoming sexually active, whether it's just exploring each other or it's kissing or fondling or anything, but it started. It's much early on. At 12, we already have girlfriends and boyfriends in the class. And if you don't, there's stress. It's peer pressure. Nobody likes you. That's another topic altogether we will have to handle in the coming years. These comparisons. So all these topics together in totality makes sex education. It's not just about the sexual act. When do we start educating is the first question that comes into an adult's mind, especially the parents, and they also feel that this topic is mainly for the girls. Oh, I have a girl, so for me it is very important to know when to start. But the boy is an equal human. He has an equal part in the reproductive whole system. Both are 50-50. So it's not just the girls that you have to educate, it's the boys also that you will educate. So as I've mentioned here, there are certain things that we say, you have to start at birth. Now how do you start at birth, people say? The child doesn't understand anything. He doesn't even know the language you're talking. How do you start at birth? So do you have any ideas? How would you start at birth? Actually, in the womb. Yes. So when the child does not even know you, does not understand the language you're speaking, so at birth when we say is when the child is born, that is when you know the gender. So as soon as you know the gender of the child, automatically that child has already been planned who will be raising that child. If it's a girl child, it will always be the mother. Of course it is changing with the time, but not so much that we can see a drastic change in what has been happening till now. Ladki hai, wo apni, uski maa usko bada karegi. Her mother will explain things to her. He's a boy, oh he's gonna be like me, a sportsman or a businessman. So already a gender has been allocated to that body. And our understanding of that gender, we are passing on to the child. Second thing, since the child doesn't understand our language, what does the child understand? At birth, after birth, how does the child know that these are my parents? We can automatically see the child, jiske haath mein aata hai when he comes to the mother. How does the child know who these people are? By touch, yes. So the touch, how you touch the child is where your sex education starts. So when you are bathing the child, when you're cleaning the child, how you perceive or how you understand and how you behave while cleaning the genitals, making sure she's healthy or he's healthy, he's clean, that is the bhav that we are passing on to the child. That is the touch. Our touch, immediately they understand. So if you don't clean the genitals today and think ki jab bada hoga main unko sikha dunga, like if the father is giving the bath to the child, you know, so immediately he'll be like, baki main hela dunga. But this genital the mother has to clean. It happens, you know, whether it's a boy. So the mother will say, why don't you look into it? To see if the, you know, while he's passing pee or when they are changing diapers. So that is where we are putting this whole discomfort into a child, saying that these are the areas which has something which we don't touch and we don't talk about. So without verbally talking to them, we are passing on our taboo and hesitation to them. When we were children, okay, let's forget about today's generation. When we were children, did we ever ask our parents what is this area called? Why? Hum log baki sab poochte the. But that was after we understood the language, no? Yeah? But we would never dare ask anything about these genitals. Shame, shame hai, kapde bagair ghoomo nahi. There were some parents who would let the kids go out, like be yourself. But most of them, ek to girl child hui, to she's locked into the entire cloth system and ye nahi dikhna chahiye, wo nahi dikhna chahiye, aise baitho, waise baitho. So there are so many things as children, we have been programmed. And we never questioned because we took it as understanding, as a learning, and we behaved accordingly. In spite of all this, we never asked what is its name. They would give us any nicknames. Abhi bhi wohi nicknames chalu hain. No, I'm not blaming anybody. I am just understanding the system, how it followed. Let's talk about India, okay? The sculptures on that walls, it says everything about sexual activity. The book, the only book in the world that has been written on sexual energy or sexuality or sex, we call it, was from India. This is what my mentor has taught us, you know, when we attended lectures with Dr. Rajan Bhosle. So this is what he says. Tell me, why, if this was what our culture was, let's discuss this. Where is that monument based? It's right in the middle of a town. It's not in some outskirts where nobody can come in, nobody would watch. It's right in the middle. So everybody was okay with it in that times. Somebody funded it. The kings, the rich people, so they were okay with this whole topic. They were okay building such a monument. There were people who worked over it. They did a fantastic job. They were okay doing the job. It's called a temple. So the religion was okay with it. Where did the taboo come in between? We have understood sexuality as a science in India. It was understood as a science. It was studied. It was known. It was told that this is how things are. This is how it will be. What is a woman? What is a man? What are their energies? How to come together? Everything was explained. Every aspect of sex was explained. But now there was some time. I will not get into it. We have less time. But somewhere the taboo came in. And our ancestors started following, and then our parents, and then us, and now our children. But it's breaking slowly. It is breaking slowly. People are understanding we need to be more loud about it. We need to be more accepting about it. Nobody is talking here about standing on the stage and saying, oh, I can talk about sex. That's not what we are saying. But at least understand yourself. Then you will be able to understand your partner. Then it will be easy for you to talk to your children. Coming back as parents, only if we are comfortable, then we can talk to our children. If we are only not comfortable and you sit down to talk about these things, the child will immediately know. And kids don't listen to us. They watch us. Yes, they learn through the eyes, not through the ears. So well said, sir. So when they are watching your body, I'll come to that. So when they are watching you and you're not comfortable with it, they're not going to take it. They're not going to buy your story. So at birth, you start with the touch. Be very, very comfortable with the gender of your child. Do not discriminate over there. Second, 1.5 to 2, yes. No, it uses all 5 senses. The child understands our touch first at birth. He's still not understanding the language. He's listening, but he does not know the words. So that is where at 1.5 and 2, when he's forming the language, even from birth, you start naming the body parts correctly. You teach the child that I'm cleaning your, okay, I want to genital. Penis and a woman's genital, we call it vagina. The vagina is actually the passage from the main outer opening to the uterus. So the outer organ, outer part is called the vulva. So when we are cleaning the child and we talk to them, you know how we tell them, now I'm cleaning your hands, now I'm cleaning. So to make them comfortable with the body parts and the body naming, so that's where you have to say, okay, now I'm cleaning your vulva. So when you talk it as a matter of fact, like any other body part, the child will never take it as a different body part or feel ashamed about it. It's a body part just like a hand and the leg. So when the child is born, one, the way you touch the child. Secondly, you have to start naming the body parts correctly. You have to tell them that this is your penis, this is your vulva, this is your anus, this is how you clean it. That's all slang, sir, and yes, there's so much of slang, yes. Education to do with being comfortable with this topic. What the books are teaching us and the degrees that we attain is very different than what you actually need to be as a parent. You have to understand what your child will need, what you have gone through yourself to be able to take your children away from those painful moments you had. So yes, sir, whether educated or not, this is the scene today. So you have to use the correct words, tell them what it is. That's where you also feel very empowered. So today, if you can say the word vulva and penis to your child, I'm 100% sure you can take the talks forward. If you know a little bit about it, if you've read a little bit about it, you've spoken to experts, definitely you can talk to your child. So it's very important to start naming the body parts. Today we also have a lot of sexual abuse happening with children. So today if you don't empower your children with naming the body parts, how in the world are they going to come and tell you what is happening with them? Good touch, bad touch also we name it differently as appropriate, inappropriate, safe, unsafe. Because an inappropriate touch could also feel good. Because at the end of it, it is sexual energy. And every child is born with it. So I have known adults who came and told me, who come and tell me that Niyati, though it was abuse, which we didn't understand, but we enjoyed it. We liked it. So by saying ke anything that makes you feel good is a good touch, we are actually giving them the wrong understanding. So again, there are different ways of handling that topic. But coming back, naming the body parts is extremely important where the child can freely come and talk to you about if something has happened. So rather than him going or her going through all that, feeling hesitant, not speaking out, not knowing what to say, empower them with the vocabulary. Very, very important. How to start, when to start is while taking a shower. So always grab an opportunity to talk to your child. You cannot just start, okay, today sit, I want to talk to you. So in a shower, when you're singing rhymes to them, singing poems to them, or talking to them about it, that is when you start that, okay, now I'm going to clean your genitals. This is an integral part. This is how you clean it. Don't hurt yourself. Use light soaps. So whatever needs to be told to them, that is the time, the best time to be given to them, right? So it is very important to start at birth, start young, so that when later on you want to talk to them, you don't hesitate. Ab kahan se shuru karu? So it's best done then. Of course, no time is a late time. Whenever you feel you have, find a way, find means, find the vocabulary, find how to grab those opportunities and talk to them. But talk to them, you know. How do I start talking to them? Like suddenly I have never spoken about these topics. I told you when to start, but how do I start talking? Because I've never spoken as a parent. So first point is you have to be comfortable yourself. Only when I, when you know, my body language does not show any hesitation, like
it's easy for another person to absorb what I'm saying. Similarly, the parent should not feel hesitant. So even if you're giving correct information, but if you're tight, your body is tight, you are like not looking to at the child and talking, you're looking here and there and talking, he will immediately know kuch to gadbad hai. There's something wrong about this which mom is not telling me. She's trying to say something and they'll pick up all the non-verbal communication happening with them. They are hardly listening to you, as we already said. So, and be crisp. Don't make it too long. Don't say a lot of things to them. Make it crisp, make it nice, make it as much as they want to hear. Sometimes we go on and on wanting to give them every piece of information. No, it has to be age appropriate also. So if your child is young, talk only as much as they could understand. If the questions are more, either you tell them, let me come back to you, or give them the correct answer which probably they will not understand any which ways, and then tell them, I think once you grow up a little bit, you will understand it better. So that is how we will be talking to our children. As I am saying here, talk as much as the child is comfortable and buy time. So a lot of times parents say, but I only don't know the answers. Sometimes when my child comes and just throws a question at me, I say, buy time. Tell your child that, okay, just wait, I don't think I am comfortable or confident with the answer. So let me just go back, read or take some help and come back to you and tell you what it is. The child will be absolutely okay. But go back and answer.
Yes. Or you can take the help of a psychologist.
Anybody. Books are there to help you. Experts are there to help you. Doctors are there to help you. There are a lot of aware parents who will help you. People like me will help you. Help is there. You just have to know that I want to do it. And what your child's age is and how much you can give. It's all out there. It's just the matter of wanting to do it. So buying time, it's not only for this topic, for any topic. So buying time is extremely important, and then going back is even more important. Because with this, you are building a platform of trust with your child. You're actually setting up a platform for the later years. Ye abhi chota chota lagega. When the children are young, this seems to be very small things to do. But you're actually starting to create a platform to talk to them. So when a teenage, you want to tell your child that don't wear such clothes and move out. So what if you're going in a mall? Don't wear such short skirts or shorts. If you're going to a friend's house, it's okay. So it's a parent's discretion where it's okay and where it's not. Who are you traveling with? How are you traveling? What are the places you will be going? What is the understanding level or the acceptance level of such clothes at that place? So when you give reasons to your child, the child understands what you're talking about. But if you're just going to say, because I'm telling you, I understand better, you cannot wear this and go anywhere, he's going to rebel. Because at that time, any which ways, they are trying out the independence. They are exploring the independence. So they are going to rebel with whatever you say because they don't want to be within your reach anymore. They
you tell them, you know, when you are going, you don't accept anything, food acting from a stranger, it may contain drugs, you know, then they can understand.
Only when you give reasons.
Yeah, reasons.
So, yes.
Why?
Why? Their first question is always why? And we never have answers for
that. It contains drugs.
Because the sky is so high.
Because the sky is so high.
Why?
Parents, it's very difficult for parents nowadays. One, lack of time. Second, lack of understanding themselves. We don't know why we do it. We just do it. The world is not good outside. How is the world not good outside? How do they know what part of not good are we talking about? When we say the world is not good outside, you can't wear such clothes and go. The teenager will be like, I know what I'm doing, I know where I'm going. why even the known people could be a threat is what we have to make them understand. Then they will be like, okay, mom, looks like you know better than what I know. You've seen life more than what I have seen. I will listen to you. At least let me give it a thought. Maybe she'll still have another way of doing things, but she'll definitely reflect to what you're saying. But that can happen only when you have that platform, right? When there's trust. And where there have been instances where you've been right about things. So the child knows that what my mom talks to me is out of love, out of concern for me. So I will give it a thought. So it is extremely important to build this platform for them and not suddenly go one day and say, now that you're a teenager, I have to talk to you. By that time, probably they'll come and tell you, what do you want to know? It's happening. It's happening all over. Yes. Why do we need to talk? We've already, you know, spoken about some points to avoid Google. Because that's the first place they go when there's a question in their mind. First they'll ask their peer, let's go Google. Though this is a fantastic tool, no doubt about it, but how much is going to come in front of them? What is going to come in front of them? And who's going to explain if it is something beyond what their understanding should be? So why should kids Google when you have parents at home? And every home will have a different value system. Every country, every city will have its own culture. So today when these young kids say, here you don't even let me wear my underwear and move around, but when we go out of town, we are wearing swimming costumes, ladies are wearing bikinis, why there it is okay and here you don't allow me? Then we don't have answers. So it is important for them to understand that every country, every city, every place has its own culture. That is how they have been. That is how we have been. This is our understanding. For them it is okay. For us it is not. So there's a lot of explanation you need to give. Where will it come from? Only when you have read about it, when you've understood about it. And when we don't know, we'll try to shut them out. So don't do that. Again, buy some time, read up on it and give the answers to your child. Kissing has been such a normal thing nowadays in the movies. And with being nuclear families, not all parents can leave their kids back at home with somebody or the other to go watch, have that some entertainment in their life. So they take the children and go. Though, I mean, I am absolutely against taking children to the movies, but we understand where a lot of parents come from. And they watch all this. And then they question. Then they go replicate it somewhere else. A lot of mothers kiss their children on the lips because I love you. I am your mother because I love you.
I can kiss you.
Kiss here, kiss anywhere. Why lips? Because kissing on the lips activates certain energy. Maybe not for the young ones. But they are taking this beyond homes. They are taking it out. Tomorrow the young child will say, I love my neighbor too. I'll go kiss him. I love my friend at school. So I kissed him. But then, with that kissing scene, how will the teacher react? How will the other parent react? So know what you're giving your child. Kissing on the lips is not okay. It's not okay. Because it is meant for a couple, and that's how we teach our children. We say it's for married couples to leave that window open. We do not say don't kiss on the lips at all. We leave the window open because we don't want that child to have those hesitations and an understanding that kissing on lips is wrong. And then later on in life, go and have a partner and then not be able to give in. So you have to leave those doors open for communication and to say that later on in life, it is okay when you understand it. Of course, they are not going to wait. This generation is not going to wait till they are married. But at least till then, they will. Whoever they see, they will think, okay, they are together as partners. Then you can take the talks forward. Age-appropriate information, as I said. So for the little ones, when they can, you know, there's a very, very innocent question that comes from three-year-olds. Where do babies come from? And most of us will go saying, "Bhagwan ki den." No. There are appropriate answers to it. So you could say the baby comes from a special bag in mama's womb. It's called the womb. It's here in mama's tummy. That's where a baby grows and then the baby comes out. Yes, a little older child will say, how does it come out? It's very simple to say there is a birth canal, which is called a vagina. So when the baby is ready, the bag starts pushing the baby out and the baby comes out from that canal. So when you say it so simply, it is not taken, it's not understood grossly or, you know, as a taboo or...
No emotion attached.
No emotions attached. It's science. It's simple science, as you say, where the urine will be coming out and where the stools will be coming out, where babies come out. It's a part of the human body. But when you talk so simply, it's understood simply. But then you say, how do I tell you? Then the child will be
Google
aa jata. Then Google aa jata. Ye mom ne kyun kuch chupaya kya? Has she not told me something? She was very hesitant. So very important to be very simple and scientific about it. Very, very scientific. Use the terms and be saved.
Sometimes we are feeling in emotions.
Parents.
I don't want to press child as well. Oh, you're gone. The mother said,
imagine such a deep question that child has asked.
The question is, who am I? She's asking.
We have been looking for that answer for our lives.
I think she would have, actually we are Atma, but she would have a small child. Hey, you have a child, you can go home. I think it's the right answer.
It's very important to answer a child because you're building up that personality, you're building up the, you're raising a child. So whether any other topic we are still okay with, this topic specifically needs to be covered.
So more importantly, one doesn't know the answer. You are cranking up and saying, I'm sorry, I'm not knowing the answer.
Yes, it's very important to let them know parents also don't know everything. We are not Bibles, we are not gods, we are parents, and I'm here to support you, be there for you, provide with whatever you want, give you the understanding of right and wrong. As I was saying, values and culture is also very important to be instilled in a child. Today I might be okay sending my child for an overnight to a friend's house, but another parent would not be. So this argument about her mom lets her go but you don't let me go is a story in every house. So how are you going to explain that to her? So you have to tell her that every house's home's values are different. That's how her parents feel. This is how your parents feel. Give her an understanding from where you are coming. Why your values are different than the others. Then the child will adopt it, accept it and understand it. But otherwise she'll keep comparing and the other mother is always good. And then we become the villains rather than being the support system for them. To teach respect and consent. If we don't teach how to respect the other gender, whether it's to respect a woman or to respect a man, it's basically to respect a human being. Today we lack respect for one another in the same homes. Whether it's the mother-in-law and daughter-in-law, whether it's the husband and the wife, whether it's the father and the son, the respect is only asked. Because I'm older, you have to respect. Respect comes in all shapes and sizes, in all age groups. And respect is a two-way street. Only when you respect, you get respect. And that the children need to understand when it comes to sexual activity also. When the partner says, I'm not okay with it, you have to respect the partner's comfort or likes and dislikes. You cannot force yourself. That is what today's generation need to understand. That because I am your boyfriend, I can do whatever I want with you, it's passé, it's not going to happen anymore. The girls are being taught to say no. The girls are being taught to voice it out. The suppression is no more going to remain a suppression when it's a duty. It's an equality now. So you have to understand, you have to teach that respect to your child. Yes, and the consent. Ask for permission. They just don't go and take it as your right. You have to ask for permission. You have to ask, are you okay with it? Are you alright if I touch you like this? Are you okay if I did this to you? Of course, it's not like in every act has to have a question along with it, but there are ways of asking. Even when you start touching and how the woman responds or how the man responds is a sign you have to understand whether is she okay, is it paining, or is she not okay, she's not liking it, or is she liking it. That's how you understand one another. And imagine that relationship, where there's respect, where there's understanding, where there's acceptance. It will be far, far much better to understand oneself also. Sex education is important to first understand ourselves, to first understand what our sexuality is, our reproductive system is, our feelings are, our system, you know, entirely ourselves. Then we move forward. So sex education is important even for us as individuals. And to empower our children to make correct decisions. As we spoke earlier, who will be your partner? Is this boy just popular, that's why you like the boy? Then that popular boy will have so many other girls waiting for him. Are you sure he's only with you? Understanding about sexual transmitted diseases is also a part of sexuality education. To make them understand that, so what if you're wearing a condom? But there are other diseases that can be passed on to you. So all of it has to start from young age, so that by the time they are 16, 17, 18, the entire education has been given to them. And this education, just like any other education, is not a one-time education. It's an ongoing process. It's an ongoing process which you have to, like, how we tell our children, did you wash your hands before meals? Mm. We'll still ask, even after they have grown big, did you wash your hands? Did you brush your teeth? Have you done this? We'll always ask, because we constantly want to remind them about it. Sex education is similar. You have to constantly keep talking and asking and making sure that you've understood what you've said. So it's not a one-time talk. It's an ongoing process. Till probably after they are married also, that I'm having this trouble, what do I do? Menopause also comes under sex education. So all the way till you're an old person, till you're sexually active or otherwise, the health part of it is also sexuality education. Today's kids are global kids. They're not going to stay in the same gown or the same city or the same country. They might be anywhere in the world. And any part of the world, there are so many different parts of the world where the culture is different. So if you are raising global children today, you're exposing them to foreign languages, exploring them, giving them international boards to study. When you're making them a global citizen, this part of education is a must. Tomorrow they will be going out away from you. They'll be taking their own decisions. If they are not equipped with the understanding, what kind of mistakes can they make? And at young age, where it's more raging, where the hormones are not yet settled, it takes time to, there's so much happening in their lives that time. And only this understanding and education will help them go forward and have an understanding for it. So while parents are raising these kids, it is extremely
important. I don't want a girl, she's MA, and she don't know the family planning methods.
Actually, there was one lady who came to us while I was doing the last workshop, and she said, Niyati, I got to know that the baby is delivered out of the vagina on the delivery table. Till then, she actually thought the baby is coming out of the anus. She thought the baby will come out of the anus. She said the nurse was constantly, you know, they treated my vagina, they cleaned it and everything. And I kept wondering, finally I asked, why are you behind my vagina? That's when the nurse said, you don't know where the baby is going to come from. She didn't know. Ladies don't know, they have two openings. One for the period and the baby, which is the birth canal vagina, and one for the urine. They think it's all from one place. So there's so much you need to understand us. I mean, we need to understand ourselves then to be able to talk to our children. There are so many cases every day we deal with, we didn't know. Because nobody speaks. It is very, very important. Today, the girls get their periods. Now it is easy. Okay, the mothers are telling them, okay, you will get your periods. This is what you're supposed to use. These are napkins. You know, your stomach might ache. All that surface level information is given. But if the child asks, why am I getting this period? Then the mother has no answer.
Many do not know.
Exactly. most of them don't know themselves. So you have to tell them what periods are. And that is why, and empower the girl to feel so powerful to be able to give life. To now on, dear, later on, dear, you are going to have, you, your womb is going to be ready to nurture a child. And so there's a whole system that you have to explain to them. And feel good that you get your periods because now you have the ability to give birth to another life. That's why when, so this is how we explain that the special bag, which is called the womb, where the egg comes, like, okay, so we start with, there are ovaries where the eggs are already present in the girl's system from birth. Every month, one egg from that ovary comes out through a tube, waits there for some time for the sperm to join in. If the sperm enters the egg, it is fertilized, then it comes to the uterus and settles where the child is nurtured. Developed. But while the egg is coming out and the procedure has started, the bag creates, the womb creates a lining inside it to support the baby's nutrition, to support the baby, to support the development of the child. So when this egg is not fertilized, we take support of the sketches. When this egg is not fertilized, the lining understands when the egg comes back to the uterus, the womb, that the egg is not fertilized, there's no baby happening. So it sheds this lining.
Reddish color, yeah.
Through, and this lining is made of blood vessels and tissues. So that is what comes out of the vagina.
It's a pure blood.
It's, yes, and it's not dirty. It becomes dirty because it comes in contact with atmosphere. Mm. That is where the bacteria starts building in. That is where the smell starts coming. But the blood that is coming out is fresh.
They have to understand that it's the dead tissue that is going.
It's rare, exactly. When, if the, and if the child has, if the girl child has been told, this is the system how it works, and it could pain because the womb contracts, you could have pain. So we'll deal with it when it comes, if it ever happens to you. But it's such a beautiful thing to happen to a woman, that you will be able to give life. When you put it like that, with enthusiasm, she'll welcome those periods, rather than, there are so many children when I go to school, they tell me, we hate periods, and I ask them, you started getting them? They're like, no, but whatever we've heard, we don't want them.
Well, they don't know what is it.
They probably.
They've always seen the other side of it. Dukta hai, people are not okay with it, people are whining about it, some women are told to sit away, not enter temples, not enter kitchen. So they think it is, it's not their thing. It's like, this I don't want. But if that girl was to be explained, why is that woman sitting away? Why she cannot enter the kitchen? Or why we tell her not to touch the pickles? If scientifically it's explained to the child, she'll understand it. And she'll welcome it. Anything. The boys today have not been told about the night fall.
Yeah.
It is so important because the boy starts getting so many thoughts in his mind, and already the peers are talking about it. They feel they are losing energy.
Mm-hmm. How father should explain the nightfall to a son?
As the child starts growing 10 years, when you see that the puberty will start setting in now, by 10 years you start explaining erection first. You tell your boy that this is called an erection and how it happens, why it happens, the blood flow, the tissue. Show them the sketch and tell them this is what erection is. Then talk to them about the sperm and the semen. So you need to know your reproductive system well. Then tell them there is this liquid that will spurt out if your penis is stimulated at the time of erection. It's called semen, it has sperms. So that he knows. So you tell him that now that you will be attaining adulthood, from childhood this is your journey. So sometimes while your body is still coping with the system, sometimes this liquid comes out on its own in the night. Because in the night there are a lot of dreams, and or the way you're sleeping, or in, you know, any stimuli. Because of that you can have this semen coming out of you. Then the difference between the urine and the semen, because so many boys feel they've peed in their pants and they feel so ashamed about it, they don't want to tell anybody, they go into a shell, they feel I'm so big and this is what I did. So it's very important to talk to them from the beginning to be able to come at 10 years and talk about nightfall. That it can happen to you, don't worry. This is how you will differentiate. This is how you will clean your pants. And then you can put it for wash. That child cannot just take that pant out and expect somebody else to wash it. That's his responsibility. Just like a girl, if she's stealing her clothes with period blood, it's her responsibility to first clean it out and then give it to somebody to wash. So this is where we are building a personality.
Otherwise, the boys, they will develop a fear.
They will. They can.
I remember when I was small, you know, I ran to the doctor, and doctor happened to be a skin specialist. So I told him, the doctor told me, aisa hota hai. He told me that, not explain everything, you know. If the father will not explain a son, no, then there will be a fear.
They will.
They can.
Exactly.
They don't know.
Exactly.
Even the same thing happened to the girls also.
Yes. So it is extremely important. There are so many factors that need to be spoken. It's not just the sexual activity. There's lots and lots and lots. Even how their relationships will be in the future depends on how you have explained it.
And then negatively start, oh, and that created problems.
That created a lot of problems. We have so many cases coming for marriage counseling because they are not compatible, they don't know what to do. There's so much of emotional burden that they have with each other that sexual is gone out of the window, out of the house.
Nature has created a wonderful system.
It has.
Nature.
We need to go back to it to understand. But that a parent's responsibility to start young. What is your role? Very quickly I'll finish. What is your role as a parent? To provide your family perspective. To make them understand what your family believes in. Support your child's level of comfort. So if today you want to talk about the whole thing but the child stops somewhere in between, carry it later.
Mm.
Don't force it on the child because they're not listening after that to you. Be honest, be patient. Honesty is the only key. If you want your child to come back and ask you questions, you have to be honest. If you're trying to evade the topic or say something different or just lie about it, that child sometime in his lifetime is going to know you've lied. And you'll lose the trust. And it could be very soon also, it could be later in life also. But you'll lose the trust. They won't come and ask you anything. They'll go out in the world for answers. Take care of your body language. At any point in time, whenever you're talking to your children, if you're going to stand and talk to them at this eye level, it's more intimidating for them rather than sitting down and talking to them at eye level. They feel this is more comfortable to talk. They feel received. They feel like, okay, she's giving me something. They'll receive it better. Your eyebrows, your eyes, your facial expressions, very, very important when you talk. And teach consent and respect, which is extremely, extremely important in today's times when people are having notions about what their rights are. The girls are not taught to say no, though it has started. But how much percentage of people really welcome this topic to be spoken at?
Both things are important. They must learn to say no as well as they must learn to say yes.
Absolutely. They have to learn to say yes also. So important. So as a parent, this is the role in short that I have put it in. And that's the end of the session here today. Any questions that you all have for me? So anyway.